Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you this morning. I'd like to thank SIFMA for inviting me to speak at the 40th annual conference, and also to give my perspective as a business practitioner on events and regulatory changes that are affecting all of us. I'm going to speak this morning on how past industry events and mistakes led to regulatory reform, how current regulatory reform will continue to impact our technology and operation requirements, and lastly, how we can continue to mitigate risk and improve our processing in order to help with our firm's profitability. To help you understand my perspective, I've spent over 40 years in the financial services industry at Pershing and serving on a number of industry boards and committees. Pershing is a global industry leader in providing investment solutions such as trade execution, clearance and settlement, custody, technology, and investment solutions for broker-dealers, registered investment advisors, hedge funds, and 40 Act funds. And this gives us a unique perspective on the industry. For the past 4 years, Investment News has ranked Pershing as a leading clearing provider in the US, and we're also a leading clearing provider in the UK, Ireland, and Australia. We serve over 1,500 financial services institutions, and they have approximately 5.5 million active investor accounts, and they hold over $1 trillion in assets. Our parent company, BNY Mellon, is a global leader in investment services and investment management. BNY Mellon is a strong financial institution, having performed well in the post-crisis stress test led by the Fed, and we share the highest credit ratings from both Moody's and S&P. So now that you know a little bit about my background and our firms, let's take a look back to 1987 to see how past events triggered regulatory reform. Back in 1987, we were celebrating the New York Giants Super Bowl victory over the Denver Broncos. Well, we were celebrating if, like me, you were a Giant fan. The Cosby Show was the number one TV show in America. Michael Jackson debuted the album Bad. Michael Douglas told all of us that greed is good in the classic movie Wall Street. And the stock market crash was a wake-up call for us that we had to change our policies and practices in order to keep up with the ever-changing financial services environment. On October 19th, 1987, the Dow Jones Industrial Average dropped 508 points, a 23% loss in a single day, the second biggest one-day drop in the history of the exchange. This is commonly referred to as Black Monday. This prompted officials at the exchange to invoke circuit breaker rules for the first time, which halted all trading. This was a very controversial move, and it quickly led to a change in that rule. Trading from then on would halt for 1 hour, 2 hours, or the rest of the day, depending on how much the Dow dropped, 10%, 20%, or 30%, respectfully. The guidelines have changed over the years. But the rationale behind the trading halt was to give investors a chance to cool off and reevaluate their positions. Black Monday was followed by Terrible Tuesday, a day in which the exchange's systems did not perform up to standards, and many firms had difficulty completing their transactions for the day. So the 1987 stock market crash led to several regulatory reforms and changes. During the week of October 19, 1987, some NASDAQ market makers formally withdrew from market making activity and did not answer their phones. To prevent this from happening again, the NASD strictly limited acceptable reasons for NASDAQ market makers to withdraw from market making. Additional changes that were put into effect as a result of the crash include the introduction of the order confirmation transaction system, permitting automated trade executions up to 100,000 shares, and the initiation of trading halts when material news is reported on a particular company. Lastly, to increase transparency and further reduce risk, in 1989, NASDAQ launched the Automated Confirmation Transaction Services Act, which we all refer to as ACT, and that enables same-day trade comparisons. Another example of industry issues resulting in regulatory reform is the mutual fund breakpoint challenges that began in 2001. The main issues was when firms were calculating the breakpoint discounts on Class A shares, they were unable to accurately account for all existing customers' holdings. This resulted in a failure to deliver mutual fund breakpoint discounts to investors. In response, the SEC and NASD took disciplinary action against 15 brokerage firms for failure to deliver mutual fund breakpoint discounts during 2001 and 2002. The firms had to undertake corrective measures and compensate clients for the overcharges, as well as pay fines that exceeded $20 million. In response, the industry came together and implemented several changes, such as creating a standardized checklist for brokers to facilitate the identification of breakpoint opportunities. Secondly, the development of a written disclosure document for the end investor that disclosed which breakpoints were available to them. And finally, broker-dealers were required to transmit tax identification numbers to mutual fund companies or their transfer agents so that related accounts could be electronically identified and linked for breakpoint purposes. These are just two examples of how industry events have impacted regulation to enhance controls, mitigate risk, and protect investor assets. We recently entered the fifth year since the most recent financial crisis began, and we continue to be in a period of historic global economic, political, and regulatory change. And we continue to experience historically low interest rates, low global economic growth rates, and stubbornly high unemployment rates. By now, we all realize that we need to manage our businesses as if the economic, political, and regulatory changes we are experiencing will continue for the foreseeable future. In fact, in the past 3 years, the U.S. has added 106 new major federal regulations across all industries, adding more than $46 billion per year in additional costs for Americans. And a recent study by the Institute of International Finance reports that as a result of financial sector regulatory reform alone, the U.S. GDP is projected to be 2.7% lower than it would otherwise be by 2015. In isolation, each regulatory proposal is a well-intentioned effort to strengthen the integrity of our markets and to protect investors. In the aggregate, there's an awful lot of work that we all need to do to comply. I'm going to spend the next few minutes on some of the current regulatory changes and their impact on all of us. The first regulatory reform I'll touch on is credit default swaps, which is one component of the Dodd-Frank Act. This reform forces the mandatory clearance of over-the-counter swaps, including credit default swaps, at a central clearing organization like the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. Central clearing is intended to reduce systemic risk by forcing bilateral contracts to be centrally cleared by a clearinghouse. The clearinghouse acts as the buyer to every seller and the seller to every buyer. This will eliminate the interconnected web of contracts between financial institutions. It will increase the reporting and transparency requirements and force both sides of the trade to be collateralized. This centralization will give regulators more transparency on the size of these transactions to better identify and mitigate risk. Inevitably, the cost of trading OTC derivatives will become more expensive for the buy side for two main reasons. New clearing fees will have to be assessed, and the additional cost of having to post collateral against all trades. The flip side of that is that the cost of clearing will actually benefit dealers, as the capital costs will be less than maintaining trades on a bilateral basis. The second regulatory reform I'll discuss is Consolidated Audit Trail, which is slated for approval in December of this year. As many of you know, this is the SEC's response to the lack of ability to recreate the events that led to the flash crash of 2010. The Consolidated Audit Trail is a multi-layer plan that ultimately will require all aspects of the order and execution to be recorded and sent to an industry utility on a T+1 basis. This reform will require significant technology changes in order to process orders and trades in compliance with the rule. Our industry will have to reinvent trade processing so that all strikes, times, and allocations are tied together, which is much different than the current model that most of us use. Ultimately, these changes will give the regulators the information they need to complete more thorough investigations and reviews. A tool that can potentially help all of us meet this regulatory change is something that we refer to as big data. Due to enhanced requirements, we are now mandated to store more data than ever before. And as this data continues to grow exponentially, so does the cost to store it. Big data is used to describe the growth, availability, and use of data. And it provides an opportunity to leverage data in new ways to make better decisions and operate more efficiently. Big data is what companies like Amazon and Netflix depend on to guide their clients towards products that they have shown an interest in the past. Big data technology can improve our ability to accurately score credit risk and help us predict problems before they occur. At Pershing, we use big data technology to provide a Google-like search that spans all different types of financial data, allowing our clients to get to their data in a simple and expedient manner in order to respond to the regulatory requests and also perform data analysis for internal use. Big data technologies enable firms to sift through large volumes of data and draw quicker and more accurate conclusions from the data. Big data technology can potentially be used for initiatives like the Consolidated Audit Trail. Next, I'd like to turn our focus to how security, risk, and resiliency play a vital role in managing our businesses on a daily basis. When it comes to security, risk, and resiliency, the landscape is very different and continues to change annually. We always knew that data security would be a critical risk requirement, but the rise in cyber attacks has escalated tremendously over the years. Just last week, the Associated Press had their Twitter handle compromised, and a false tweet about explosions in the White House were sent to over 2 million AP followers. This momentarily spiraled the Dow Jones Industrial Average into a free fall and created a slight frenzy on Wall Street. In addition, global news publications like the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal have had their systems violated, challenging the safety of the story, of their story sources, and the integrity of their entire operations. This is a timely hot topic as the House of Representatives recently approved the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act, which would develop a framework for sharing cyber threat information between companies and the government. Protection from the data requires a multi-stage roadmap and a significant budget to stay ahead of these malicious attacks. Operational risk is also something we need to manage and help mitigate on a daily basis. This past fall, Hurricane Sandy provided lessons for all of us and demonstrated the value of good disaster recovery and business continuity plans. But knowing and actively planning for disaster recovery are not the same thing. Sandy highlighted the importance of having data centers in geographically dispersed locations, and that multiple active data centers is really no longer a luxury, but a requirement. Diligent root cause analysis and robust enhancements to our DR and BC plans are necessary to remain resilient in this ever-changing environment. Another security threat to our industry is the recent increase in third-party disbursement fraud. There has been an increase in client funds stolen as a result of instructions emailed to firms from client email accounts that have been compromised. These incidents highlight the risk associated with accepting email instructions to transmit funds to a third party, either via Fed Fund Wire, check, or ACH payment. FINRA recommends that firms reassess their policies and procedures to ensure that they are adequate to protect client assets from such risks. Some best practices for all of us to keep in mind are directly confirming all third-party requests with the end investor, train our staff to recognize red flags associated with disbursement fraud, such as requests for the benefit of an unrelated third party, instructions which convey an unusual sense of urgency, and difficulty in reaching the client through normal channels. The industry is also experiencing fraudulent account openings. Here's an example of a common scenario. The perpetrator opens a fictitious brokerage account with debit card margin and ACH privileges, then deposits a large dollar fraudulent check. Prior to the check bouncing, the perpetrator places a trade for blue chip securities and then attempts to use the margin availability created from the purchase to withdraw funds via the debit card. In light of this increased fraud, firms should review ACH and check hold policies and consider increasing their standard hold times, revisit enhanced due diligence and KYC policies for all new accounts, be alert for calls requesting immediate access to funds via debit cards or special requests for debit card access to new accounts. And finally, pay close attention to new accounts that receive large checks and make purchases of securities before the checks have cleared. Many of us remember moving from T+5 to T+3 back in 1995. And now the conversation is around reducing the settlement time to T+2. By taking one day out of the settlement cycle, counterparty and market risk is reduced. Also, since collateral required by central clearing facilities is determined by unsettled trading obligations, one less day of trades pending settlement would translate into reductions in collateral required by the CCFs. This reduction in settlement cycle impacts broker-dealers, banks, money managers, and institutional investors, as we will need to re-engineer our processes to meet shortened industry settlement cycle. As this slide shows, there will be a significant investment required to move to T+2, but the reduction in risk and eventual cost savings seems to make this a worthwhile initiative. However, as an industry, we need to figure out how to design technology solutions for T+2 that can be reusable for the eventual move to T+1. Otherwise, we're going to have a lot of throwaway expense. Our industry has transformed in many ways over the past 40 years since the first SIFMA operations conference. The unprecedented pace of regulatory reform will continue to transform our business. And to succeed in this environment, we all need to embrace transformational change to make our businesses stronger and provide more value to our clients. As business leaders, we need to share our industry knowledge and collaborate with legislators, regulators, and each other. We look at the future with optimism, and we hope you do too. So thank you for your time this morning.